Good evening. I think you're still muted.
How are you doing today, sir? You doing good?
I'm excited to be here.
Me too. Me too. I'm looking forward to it.
This is the favorite part of my job. What are you talking about? This is the time we get to play.
Oh my God, love it. Love
I'm always excited to get to have class. It's a
Yeah.
good feeling. Hope nobody jumps on Teams. I'll probably have to jump over there and see if everybody doesn't show up.
Okay.
The Teams is the backup for the semester. We're going to discontinue Zoom at some point, but
Okay. I know we don't use that anymore at CMS.
yeah. So we're going to discontinue Zoom and move over to Teams at the college as well.
Okay.
And so, but I wanted to make sure that we met a couple of times on Zoom to start with to make sure everybody could get into Teams and
Okay.
get their account set up. Some of the other folks decided to try Teams to start with. It's not gone well tonight and last night. Hey, Sarah. And so
Hi, Sarah. How are you?
hey, Sarah, can you hear us yet?
Yeah, sorry. For some reason, it wasn't. I could see y'all talking, but I couldn't hear
All right.
anything.
Well,
I
yeah. It's better if you can see me than hear me most of the time, as you already know.
apologize.
No, we were just talking about some of my colleagues tried to go straight, didn't try to transition from Zoom to Teams, and it has not gone well the last 2 nights. Some people can't get in, some people haven't established accounts, all that business. So we're going to start for at least a week or two on Zoom, then we'll switch over once we're sure everybody's going to get what they need. Hey, Daryl. And and we're all still trying to learn all the things, all the different functions of Teams. What I do like about it generates transcripts. I do like that. Like for y'all, when you do your interviews, for your dissertation. Right now, if you use Zoom, you have to go through Otter AI to transcribe them. But you can do, if you use Teams and do virtual interviews, you can, it generates a transcript for you. And then you can clean that up and send it to me, and I put it in InVivo. We can do inductive coding for your thematic analysis of your dissertation. Makes it pretty easy.
Awesome.
Works pretty well. So that's one advantage that I can see. There are probably some others. Who knows? So, Sarah, have you picked a topic yet?
Well, I've been emailing you. I'm
Yeah, I
narrow.
know.
Yes. Yes, I'm narrowing it down. I'm gonna go the easier route.
Clear path to data.
Yeah.
I'd study snakes if I could get the data. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about is do you have a clear path to data? And I don't want to throw anybody under the bus that works out in the districts. I am so thankful that they work with us. But if the people on your committee out in the districts can't help you get data, I don't know what their purpose they serve. Part of the problem with that is we kind of suffer through some of their ideas. They want to think. It's like my position coach used to tell me, don't think, you're hurting the team. We just need for you to put your head in the linebacker's ribs when he comes across the middle on that curl. You just use your head to hit him. But what I find is the reason why we would involve somebody from your district to be on your committee is they help us with that clear path to data. If they don't, then their value then becomes in question. That's ugly. I know. But unfortunately, we've had too many cases where they couldn't deliver the goods, but they wanted to have ideas and wanted to change the study and wanted to think and wanted to, to do stuff that was not in the candidate's best interest. And so, you've got to find a path to data, something that your district will let you do, and that there's that you can see how you could get to that data. So that's it. So we're going to have a we'll have one of our sessions will be about dissertation before the semester is over. Probably be the last one. But I think I've got Qualtrics for one Saturday. We'll talk about Qualtrics too. Y'all know what y'all use Qualtrics? The survey generating tool that's free. GardaWeb's bought you an account that's in Web Connect. Y'all don't use Qualtrics to do surveys. Yeah, we've got a lot of handy dandy tools. And the good thing about Qualtrics surveys is it does your descriptive analysis for you of your data. Well, I mean, it's simple. It's mean, median, mode, standard deviation. It's not heavy lifting. There's no inferential statistics in it. It's just descriptive. But it does do that for you, and it makes really nice surveys. And so we have that tool. That helps. And again, now we're using Teams. It will do your transcripts if you're doing a mixed and you're doing a survey and interviews. You can generate your transcripts for your interviews if you do them virtually. I always suggest that you do that. Otherwise, it's gets a little bit lengthy if you do them face to face. But this is 7:34. And so this is your third semester, and so it's time to start thinking about topics. It's time to start exploring what tools you have available to you. Hey, Jonathan, how are you? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I wonder if anybody else is over on the other one. Okay, let me see. I don't think there's anybody over there, but I'll look. I didn't see anybody over there. I think we're good. Y'all haven't heard from anybody. Let me check my email that might have mistakenly went to the Teams meeting. No, I don't see anybody. All right, I've got 7:04. Let's get started. All right, I'm Dale Lamb. I'm be your instructor. I'm also full-time faculty. I've been with Gardner-Webb since I retired from public schools. I did 32 years in public schools. Been with Gardner-Webb for 14. Don't do the math. Yes, I'm that old. And so I am the chair of the leadership division at Gardner-Webb in the College of Education, and most specifically for you, I am the program coordinator for EDLS. So if you have any complaints, that would be me. I am available. My information is in the shell. You can call or email me. I will respond. I'll get back to you. So let me share my screen and I'll show you my information and then we'll let you introduce yourselves. All right. So here's our shell. That's going to make me sign back in. No, that's all right. And so you should have seen everything in here. These pictures mean something. That's Jennifer Kroymans. Can you see Jennifer? She finished last December. She defended her proposal on the last day of summer and she walked across the stage in December. She's an abject lesson in getting after it and getting it done. She went from proposal. I started with her in May. She had very little. We were able to get a proposal in, let's see, June, July, in 2 months, and then she finished. Because she got after it, because she didn't get bogged down in trying to change the world. She wanted to get done. That was smart. We did the simplest methodology. We did a mixed explanatory survey interviews. She had 100% survey participation from her sample. She had 90% participation that did interviews. Had a small sample, but because her participation rate was so high, we did inductive coding. We did descriptive statistics of her multiple choice survey from Qualtrics. We did inductive coding. I have the software in Vivo and I do the coding for you, find you the mat, your themes. I don't do deductive. This is not the last century. I don't do deductive coding. I only do inductive coding where the computer finds the themes for us. Now, it's a risk. It may not find the themes that the literature said you'd find. If it doesn't, then you got to go back and rewrite chapter two, but that's a risk you take. And so start here. That's Heidi. That's Talia. She came through both, started with us. This is Sarah. She went through EDCI and then did our add-on in MSA, and she's principal over at A.L. Brown. This is how many graduates we have at Gardner-Webb. We take the whole floor, just the College of Education. That's me and Frank. Frank finished last year, and Frank's the bell cow. And if you know Frank Cagle, make sure that I said this, and you tell Frank I said this. If Frank Cagle, it would have been easier to get a camel through the eye of a needle than to get Frank through the doctoral program. But you see it, don't you? So I know you got the smarts to do this. If Frank can get through, anybody can. There's Whitley. She was with us. She's a double MSA into the doctoral program. That's Razan, woman of faith. Not my faith, but she's a woman of faith. I appreciate that, doctoral student. There's a group of our ladies from EDLS. There's my hero right there, Winter Goodson. He knows Winter as tall as I am. Winter is the story of what Gardner-Webb is supposed to be about. She's principal in Wayne County. She came through the MSA and EDLS programs. She was pregnant and homeless at 14. Let me say that again. She was pregnant and homeless at 14. You can tell from the color of her skin. In North Carolina, she used to be known as what was other. She's a Lumbee Indian. And she made it. You can make it. Trust me. That nobody on this screen tonight has led a harder path than her. She made it. You will make it if you want to make it. So those are my pictures. I'll add more as the semester goes, but they all tell a story. That's the idea here. So the story is, as I've already told you who I am. All right, now I'm right here. Here's my contact information. There's my phone number. Call it. It's amazing. I know people think you can just send text and email, but it's amazing. These things you can actually talk to people on them. Call me. I will answer. My office hours are Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. I'm on campus. I set aside those 4 hours every afternoon if you need something. But you can get me by phone or email from 10 to 6. And after class, between 8 and midnight, I'll get back to you. I go to bed about 12:30. I get up at 4:30. Don't call me in the morning early, though. That's when I catch up on all my administrative duties when there's nobody in the office for them to bother me. So I am available at those times. All right, I'll stop my share. Who we got with us tonight? Sarah, I'll start with you since I know you.
Sarah Turner, I am in Danville Schools and am a math instructional coach. What else do you need to know? Is that it?
And you're debating on what as your dissertation topic?
I am doing the teacher perspective of iReady. I'm just debating on what theological framework to take.
Theoretical framework.
Theoretical framework, yes.
All right. Perception study. Perception study. We'll do a survey and interviews. How do I know that? Well, perception's an individual thing, isn't it? We wouldn't do a focus group, would we? We'd have to do interviews if we're doing a perception study. And we need a baseline. Normally, when we do a perception study, we do a mixed sequential explanatory. What does that mean? It means we do a multiple choice survey first, and then we follow up. And our interviews are an attempt to explain the results from the quantitative, the multiple choice survey. We want them to explain because that's what a perception is they explain their view of the world and how the world works. That's what qualitative is. Qualitative is people's attempt to make sense of how the world works, or at least in their view or their perception. And so that's the kind of thing that we would do. Part of the problem with doing something else with iReady, if we were trying to evaluate it, what grades do you use iReady with, Sarah?
We use it K through six,
K through
and
six.
they have they've replaced our benchmarks now with the iReady diagnostic.
Yeah.
So our district is really pushing it this year.
Yeah. So the problem with iReady, especially in K2, is it's not really a test. It's a survey of a teacher's opinion. It's hard to do an evaluation of something like that. So you'd be better off, if you're going to do an evaluation, we need scores. We need an objective score that says this is the score. Most surveys are opinion. So again, these are all methodological things that you'll learn next semester in 736. But when you're thinking about what you might want to do, now's the time to be thinking about some of that stuff, and they'll put a lot of that with you. Now, your theoretical framework, I'm asked often what's the difference between a theoretical and a conceptual framework. A theoretical framework is one theorist guides your work. A conceptual framework is when you have two theorists that guide your work. You have seminal works out there, people who have told us how their theories of how the world works, or how education works, or how adults learn. Just like our first Saturday together, you understand that our weekly classes, you will present chapters in both of the books. Sundays, you'll do your project presentation. Saturday's my day to do content. And one of those days, I'm going to be doing some theory work with you on adult learning, like Andrew Gagey. We'll probably hit Vygotsky and scaffolding. We'll definitely hit Malcolm Knowles on adult learning theory. That's Andrew Gagey. We'll hit Hertzberg on satisfaction. These are the major theorists in those areas. So if you want to do something about job satisfaction or retention, then Hertzberg's your theorist. If you want to do something on how adults learn or perceive the world, then Malcolm Knowles or Andrew Gagey. If you want to do something on scaffolding kids where you start lower and move up, then that'd be Vygotsky, Dubrovin-Brenner. There's a lot of them out there, but they basically guide our work. So you got to have a theorist that tells you what that work is going to be. So you're looking for a theorist, you're looking for a topic, you're thinking about methodologies, but all of it circles back to the kernel of truth in dissertation work. Do you have a clear path to data? So that's what Sarah's doing right now. So math instructional coach, very good. We might do something special with Sarah since she's a math person. Now, I just had one of my EDCI ladies in South Carolina. Now, the beauty of South Carolina is they don't care. They'll give you anything. North Carolina won't give you any test scores. That's the problem with North Carolina. It's hard to get test scores. That's why you have to do perception studies. See, Sarah's already smart enough to understand without test scores, we can't do an evaluation. But we can do a perception, what teachers think about iReady. So a counterpart to that is we did Big Ideas Math in South Carolina. We got the test scores, all the math scores for a very large district in the Columbia region. And we did an analysis of variance between the schools, and we did a repeated measures analysis of variance, both inferential statistics, on the kids, individual kids, because we had quarterly plus the final state exam, the SC Ready exam. But again, if you don't have scores, if you don't have test scores, we're probably not going to be able to do anything inferential like regression analysis or repeated measures or analysis of variance or even correlations. We're going to have to do descriptive, then we're going to have to add something, which is usually a qualitative piece where we do serve, where we do interviews or focus groups. That's just the nature of the business. So if you're in North Carolina, it's going to be hard for us to get scores to do inferential work. Be thinking about that. It really is. Probability is the basis of all inferential statistics. You're trying to predict something. You're trying to show a correlation between two things. That's inferential. We have to have scores if we're going to do that. We have to have test scores, basically, if we're going to do that. Jonathan, tell us about you.
My name is Jonathan Clark. I'm a principal at North Moran Middle School in Spencer, North Carolina.
Did Jamie used to be there?
Jamie
Durant?
No, he was at West Rowan.
He was at West Rowan. I get my Rowans mixed up. Y'all all look the same to me. I live just down the hill from y'all. I live right in just across the line in Mecklenburg. I live in Lake Norman and Cornelius.
Okay.
And so I used to be in Ireland, Rowan, a good bit when we still talked. Used to have a campus in Statesville. And we taught in Statesville and Mooresville. And a lot of my interns were in Mooresville City, Ardle, and Rowan. Jamie was one of our students there. But when we taught in both, we taught at Lakeshore out in Dooley, out where Lake Norman High School is. We used to teach out there. And then we taught when we had a campus up in Statesville. It was very nice. But yeah, it's a good part of the world. What are you thinking about doing for a dissertation?
So I've been looking at experiential learning, mm-hmm. but the further we get into it, I don't want to have to get any student facing data.
Yes.
Just because of the difficulty of getting through the process with it. Mm-hmm. So I was trying to pivot and move more towards like teacher retention, job satisfaction with using more hands-on learning.
Yeah.
But I'm not finding a ton of research that lines up with that. So I don't know how difficult it'll be to complete going that direction.
Job satisfaction. You know, one of the things that in a case like that, if there isn't a lot of literature in related to experiential learning, you can say there's a gap in the literature. And part of the beauty of that is when you get to chapter four, whatever data you collected, you don't have to try to match it back to what the literature is saying about your topic. When we talk about chapter four, we use validated instruments in chapter three to produce reliable results in chapter four that we can then make recommendations out of in chapter five, three, four, five. Now, some people would have you believe that chapter two is the most important of your dissertation. Some of my colleagues run around and say that out loud. I can't believe people be that dumb, but, you know, no accounting for that. But why chapter two is important is when we get to four, we have to argue that our data that we collected is reliable enough to make recommendations. And one of the ways that we do that is we compare what we found to what the literature has found previous to us. And that sometimes is a problem, especially after COVID, the world has changed. We're getting a lot of data that doesn't match the literature. That's why we're harping on you about making sure your literature's from the last 5 years. Now, not your seminal work like Hertzberg. He's from the 50s like me. That's good stuff. but we're talking about the later studies using Hertzberg. You need to be looking at job satisfaction since the pandemic. And probably there isn't a lot, but that's a good thing in chapter four, because you know you can't get beat with your data doesn't match from before the pandemic, because it won't. But I don't ever see that as a limit. You can always argue in significance of your study, there's a gap in the literature.
Okay.
And that works really well. SNS, statement of the problem, chapter one, statement of the problem, need for your study, and then significance of your study. Significance of your study is there's a gap in the literature. That's why we need to do it.
Gotcha.
Pretty easy. It's not hard. If I can do it, it's not rocket science. And you're exactly right. If you're using student-facing data, or if you're in North Carolina trying to get anything for parents because of the recent Family Privacy Act, you know, Jonathan's beard will be the color of mine before he gets through IRB. I've got one who's trying to use student-facing data. He's approaching his eighth month in IRB and still is not through. Let me say that again. He's been in IRB since January. Mm-hmm. If you're trying to collect data directly from students or use student data, IRB is full review. That's 6 months minimum. 6 months. So what we want is nobody gets exempt, but what we're looking for is expedited, take about a month. And nobody gets through IRB the first time. Everybody knows what IRB, Institutional Review Board. They review, you have to propose, after you propose your first three chapters, we have to go to IRB and they have to approve your study. It's about protection of subjects. You'll learn all about it next semester. I'll probably send you something about it this semester so you can be thinking about it. But they say whether you can do your study or not. And so they're not real big right now on letting anything but students get through. They're not big on letting anything about collecting data from parents. You know, the Family Privacy Act basically extends FERPA protection that used to just be for EC kids to all kids now. That's the easiest way to explain it. And so it's hard to collect data. It really is. It's hard to collect data now. But perception data, job satisfaction data. I mean, Jonathan, that's an easy Hertzberg study. Hertzberg's pretty easy to understand. There's things that make you happy and things that make you sad, or things that make you happy and things that make you mad. I mean, things that make you stay and things that make you go. He called them motivators and hygienes. We call them satisfiers and dissatisfiers. The only problem that I have with that is, you know, Hertzberg is a two-factor theory. He says satisfaction is not a continuum. I have students who can't grasp that concept. But other than that, once we get you to understand that, it gets pretty easy. It sounds pretty simple, but unfortunately it's not. Or in practice, it's not been for me so far. But don't take but a minute to understand it. But once you have it, it influences. It's pretty easy after that. But yeah, I like satisfaction studies. I'm a Hertzberg maven. So I like those, and they're easy to pull off. They're meaningful. She did the principles in McDowell County, but she did a wellness study, seven pillars of wellness, which is relevant now after COVID as well. You know, things like that, where, you know, this is a leadership superintendent training program. You should be looking at the health, you know, you should be looking at principals, why they stay and go. You should be looking at things above the classroom level if possible. That would be helpful. We like those leadership dissertations. All right. Welcome, Jonathan.
Thank you.
Tashira.
Hello. How you doing?
Good.
I am Tashira Newton. I am an assistant principal in Charlotte Mecklenburg Schools.
Where are you in Charlotte Mecklenburg?
I'm at Blythe Elementary.
Blythe. Yeah. I used to ride by Blythe every day, going down Bates Ford, up and down Bates Ford Road. As I said, I live at Lake Norman, and so I'd go the back way when I rode my scooter a lot.
Mm-hmm.
They've built Blythe over there. When I first moved to Lake Norman, there was no schools on that. Once you crossed 85, of course, you had West Charlotte, mm-hmm. and Northwest School of the Arts right there before you get to the interstate. Mm-hmm. And from there was nothing. So what we got now, Hornet's Nest, Long Creek.
Yep.
Blythe, Barnett. Hopewell, Bradley.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Now, I just came to Blythe. I'm coming from Ashley Park. I was at Ashley Park for 10 years, and then now I'm at Blythe.
Yep. Well, if you've been, if you made it at Ashley Park for 10 years, you're tougher than fried meat.
Yes, I hear that a lot.
Tanya was at Ashley Park, wasn't she? Tanya Kales. She's the new.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She was. She's the new deputy, and she replaced Melissa at in Gaston.
Mm-hmm.
So Melissa Balknight was the deputy in Gaston. She left, and she's now the deputy in CMS. And Tanya slipped in behind her. Tanya worked with us in CMS, and then she was at UVA. Steve brought her in when he was the interim year at Gaston, and so now she's going to be there permanently. So good people. It's important that you said, well, Dale, you just talking about whole home week. The idea here is, you know, you're doing this to get a job. This is how it works. The people you know, where you've been, the experiences that you have, the connections that you make, all those kinds of things. I mean, the degree won't get you the job. It will help and it'll get you to pay. But right. It's all those, it's all the other connections that you make and the seats that you set in along the way. I mean, I'd go to war with the sheriff. She did 10 years at Ashley Park.
That's right.
I'd saddle up right with her. I would. She'd be part of my crew. I can tell you that. I would have no problem knowing that she'd have my back.
That's right.
That's the only way to survive at a place like that.
Yeah.
It's tough duty. But what I also find is that people that can survive places like that, they care more for kids than the general person does as well. Otherwise, they wouldn't have stayed. You have to love kids to do that. Love kids. And you know, one thing about being a school administrator and people that have had to get this, the displeasure of having to sit through class with me before is you got to be champion for students.
Yeah.
You must be a champion for students if you want to be a school administrator. And anybody that can work at Ashley Park 10 years is a champion for students, or they wouldn't have survived it. They would have moved long ago. There's easier jobs, trust me, than being at Ashley Park. All right. So Daryl just went off. All right. Let's see. Oh, 1 second here. Michelle?
Yes, sir. How are you?
I'm good.
My name is Michelle Magana, and I'm a dean of students in a school in CMS.
Where are you?
The Governor's Village STEM Academy. I'm in the elementary school.
Okay. So there was Moorhead and
Nathaniel.
You're at Nathaniel?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah.
With Mr. Cook.
Cook.
Jeff Cook.
Jeff Cook. He's obviously after my time. Vincent Golden was there the last time that I was. Let's see, who else was there at Nathaniel?
Well, this is my second year. I come from North Charlotte.
So you were at WC?
Yes, WC. Yes.
You were at WC. Yeah.
Yeah, under Robinson and Hoskins.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And so. Donovan?
Donovan Hoskins, yes.
Yeah, Donovan was AP. He started out as AP at Vance.
Yes.
And then he was small school principal at one of the small schools at Olympic when they tried that suicide mission. And then he was at Smith in Guilford, right there in Greensboro off Holden Road.
Mm-hmm.
And then he came back to West Charlotte. So where is he now?
He's in Greensboro.
He went back to Greensboro?
Yes, I believe he was superintendent there, yeah. I believe. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Did a stint after Olympic. He did a stint in Guilford and Greensboro there at Smith High School right there on Holden Road, right up opposite side of the interstate from the Coliseum. Yeah.
Yeah, he's amazing.
Yeah. It's good people. So yeah, you're tough too if you worked at WC. I can tell you that, WC. So you're now where as dean of students at you're at
For the
Nathaniel.
Governor's Village STEM
Yeah.
Academy now. Yes, in the
You're at
elementary school. We have two campuses. I mean the lower campus.
They initially had two, and now they have an upper and lower.
Yes.
That was the original when Vance, right after Vance was first built. I'm trying to remember which one Nancy Hicks was at, whether she was at Moorhead or Nathaniel when it first opened. But anyway, that
That was
again.
before my time.
Yeah. So what are you thinking about dissertation wise?
Oh, I'm looking at the factors that propel Black women's decision to enhance their academic portfolio in pursuit of a doctorate degree.
Who's your sample going to be? Who you expect to collect data from? Who's your sample? Who you think your sample will be?
African American women.
Yeah, but which ones?
I'm looking at the ladies who are in their 40s and above.
Yeah,
It
but how, but what's our vehicle? What's our path to get to them? Where do they work? Who are they? This is the kind of stuff that you have to define.
Okay.
Especially for IRB. We have to define a sample that we're going to collect data from.
I'm trying to look at African American women who are pursuing doctorate degrees in
Yeah.
education.
But what's your path to them? I mean, how do we know who they are and how do we get to them?
I was hoping to get samples from UNCC, from the colleges here in North Carolina, Charlotte.
Yeah, that might be something that you want to,
Yeah.
you need to figure out if they're going to give it to you. You know, you can just do a public lookup. But yeah, your trick, the trick there is going to be how do you identify them and how do you get to them? That's going to be that again, that clear path to data. So I had a doctoral student today come by my office and said she sent me an email this morning with her survey link and wanted to know if I would send it out. You might have got it today. I sent it out for her today. Because I had told her when she was trying to figure out, I sat in on her proposal and she was concerned about where she was going. I said, if you'll come by, I'll send it out for you. I'll help you in that one. But you know, because I have access to these people. Problem is I don't have I you know who has access? Who's the gatekeeper of that information that you need to get to those people and has their email their work emails that you can get to them or try to get to them to sample them. That's what you got to be thinking about.
Okay. I noticed that when I was at UNCC, the increase in African American women in higher education. So I was thinking about using UNCC and
Yeah. Yeah. That's going to be a convenient sample. I don't know that you can generalize your findings beyond UNCC though.
Okay. I'll expand it then.
Yeah, I mean that's fine. But you know, part of the problem you get into with a convenient sample like that is that group really representative of all the women that you're looking at? That's such a small, that's just one college. There's 16. How many? The 16 state universities in North Carolina, and I think most of them offer a doctorate of some kind. And then there's another 22 private ones, and I think about 15. So there's about 40 universities that grant doctorates, and even just in North Carolina. And it's hard to argue. It's hard to argue that just the ones from UNCC are representative of all of them. Well, then you say, well, Dale, we'll just do a case study. Well, yeah, you could do that. But then we have to get UNCC to partner with us and say that we can do it. We have to have somebody that's a decision maker there if we want to do a case study. Now, if you're doing a case study, you just need that one college. But these are the kinds of things you got to think about. Now, I have one that was doing something similar on black men, and the district turned her down. And she said, well, I'll just do a snowball sample through Facebook. I'll join all these, you know, professional black men's groups, and I'll just survey them myself through Facebook. That's a good idea, but that's not a case study. Case study has to have a bounded system. That means it has to be a school or a school district, what that means. And so when you go on Facebook and do a rolling snowball on Facebook, you don't know who's answering. You might be Russian bots for all I know. And so, you know, you can do one school, but it would be a case study and you had to have their permission because you're studying them. But again, that clear path to data, that's how we start and end all these conversations is clear path to data. You know, how would we get to them? Who will give us permission? Who would give us their emails? How would we go about doing this? You know, the operational piece. You folks are LS people. You're supposed to be operational, how to make stuff run, how to make stuff work. That's what we're talking about here. All right. Is Rebecca on here? Thank you, Michelle.
I am on here.
Are you still at work?
I am. Actually, I am. And fun fact, Dr. Lamb, Jonathan and I are in the same room.
y'all are both at North Rowan?
Yes, I'm the principal at North Rowan Elementary while he's at the middle school. So we've been working on planning a professional development for our staff.
Well, good for you.
Yep.
And so who would be your theoretical framework on professional development? This is a doctoral question. Here's first pop quiz of the night. Who would be your major theorist? Darling Hammond. That's an easy one. Do you understand the relationship of Linda Darling Hammond to professional development? She's like the guru.
Mm-hmm.
That's what a theoretical framework is. Who's the guru in that area? Who knows more about professional development than Linda Darling Hammond? Nobody. So that would be your major theorist right there. Who knows more about why people stay or go than Hertzberg? Nobody. So he's your major theorist. I mean, that's what you're looking for. So when you're sitting and doing an articulated professional development plan between two different schools, that's Linda mm-hmm. Darling Hammond. She is your theorist. She would tell you how to do that.
Well, we have been working hard on it for sure.
Good. Good. I know that you have real lives. And yeah. And the work that we do needs to be real and needs to be authentic.
Mm-hmm.
That's straight from Malcolm Knowles. Now, I had the luxury when I was a doctoral student at Chapel Hill to get to work with Phil Schlechte, working on the work.
Mm-hmm.
He would be a major theorist there,
mm-hmm.
but now he's a disciple of Knowles.
Mm-hmm.
But that might be you would have a secondary theorist because Schlechte is a how-to guy.
Mm-hmm.
People ask me all the time, do I need a theoretical framework or a conceptual framework? Well, it's according to your first theorist. Does it cover both content and process? The beauty of Linda Darling Hammond is she talks about what professional development ought to be about, you know, the content of it, but she also talks about how to do it, whole group, small group, one-on-one. So mm-hmm. she covers both ends, both content and process in her theory. So you just need one theorist if you're doing her. Now, if you're doing andragogy, adult learning theory, you probably need two. Because Knowles just says, this is what you ought to do. Somebody like Schlechte, his book, you know, it's on my desk at work right now, is How to Do It.
Mm-hmm.
So you need a content and a process. What to do, how to do it. That's what guides your research, your theoretical or your conceptual framework. So if y'all planning staff development, y'all are doing theoretical work from Linda Darling Hammond, hopefully. Y'all not just making it up like kids on the playground, just scratching plays in the dirt. Hopefully y'all are you know, you have some notion of how it ought to be done. Well, you more than likely got that notion from Linda Darling Hammond. And that's how a theoretical framework works. All right, so y'all are both at North Rowan.
Yes, sir.
And so, what's the closest town?
Spencer, North Carolina.
Spencer,
right, just a little bit north of Salisbury.
Well, I know, but the Transportation Museum's out there, isn't it?
Right.
They have they still got the carousel where they used to have the engines for the train over at the museum and all that. We used to take kids over there.
They do. My students are actually going there next week.
Yeah, we used to take middle school kids over there. Do field trips over there to the North Carolina Transportation Museum. Mm-hmm. Spencer is what, halfway between Atlanta and Washington, D.C. on the map? That's why it's there. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's how it got built. It was a railroad town. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, it's good to know that two of you are from Spencer. I'll remember to talk slower, wave my hands more, like I used to have to do with Jamie Durant. That's good. Well, welcome. Daryl, tell us about yourself.
All right. I'm Daryl Peterson, assistant principal at Lincoln Charter School. I guess fun fact, you did mention Statesville, and that's where I am now. That's where I live at. So I do live in Statesville and commute to Lincolnton, about an hour away. You know, so do that every day. And that's a little bit about myself.
Yeah. So you're on the west side of the lake now. Carl, yeah. I think, joined us this. We got two more from Lincoln Charter. Carl Lacks is going to be with us this fall. He just got admitted, and one more. I had them last summer.
Jessica Kelly.
Yep. And Carl. And, you know, we've had pretty much everybody, Jonathan, everybody else has come that's been leadership at Lincoln Charter has come through us.
Right, yes.
MSA or the doctoral or both.
Exactly. And so Jessica pretty much is my boss. Like, I'm assistant principal. She's the principal. So.
Yep. You know, we're big. I actually live in your attendance zone on that side, just out past the dam. I live in Cornelius. And so that's, we have a lot of kids that go to Lincoln Charter. I live with all them rich people, but I moved in. I moved in 30 years ago. I couldn't afford to live there now.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I live with all them well-to-do people over on the southern rim of the lake. Yeah, I'll tell all my Lake Norman jokes later on, but I'll save it for the night. But yeah, I'm a big supporter of Lincoln Charter, and y'all have opened the satellite now. Your satellites were down toward Dallas.
You talking about far as satellite, far as
where for Lincoln Charter's opened a new satellite school? Well,
we have two locations. One is in Denver and Lincolnton.
Yeah, Denver. Yeah. But I thought y'all were going to head the other way too, at some point. But yeah,
that'll probably be in future plans.
Yeah, and so the one in Lincolnton is where you are. So I said the Denver one. You know, we have a good many folks that live on our side of the lake that go to the one in Denver.
Right.
And so yeah. So, but yeah, we're big supporters of Lincoln Charter. It's a good place.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. And get back here, Janiqua.
Hey, I am Janiqua Barnes. I am an assistant principal at Piedmont Charter in Gastonia at the middle school.
Piedmont Charter in Gastonia. Where in Gastonia are they all located?
You said, where are they all located?
Where in Gastonia?
Off New Hope Road is where the middle school is. And the elementary is on First, and then the high school is on, I'm brain farting, but it's not far from the middle school.
Yeah. What kind of facility is the elementary in?
It's in a very old school. Like, it was opened many, many years ago.
Yeah.
Probably the oldest in Gastonia.
Yeah. That's what I thought.
In 2020, they broke ground, well, opened the high school, new high school. And the middle school is in old Winn-Dixie.
Yeah. Big box. Yeah. Yeah. But enrollment seems to be climbing.
It is. We have maxed out. We've reached our max enrollment this year.
Yeah. So that's good. And so it seems to be going. Now, I'm a fan of all kinds of schools, private, charter, public, as long as they're good schools. That's the notion here. You know, as long as we all are doing the right thing and are championing for kids, there's no first or second class citizens. If you're serving kids, you're doing God's work. That's a good thing.
Right.
Good schools are good schools. Doesn't matter under what label. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right. Is that everybody? Did I miss anybody? All right. I'm keeping my eye on the time. Sarah's used to me looking over to the left. I'll have a clock over there. Otherwise, I'd talk all night. All right, let me share my screen and go through the shell. Now, again, the way this class works is very simple. Y'all present at our weekly sessions every week chapters in the book. And then on Sundays, you have specific assignments that you present. And then at the end of the year, you present your evidence plan from the evidence that you do. The Saturdays are mine. I present content. And so click here to open. First steps, do the verification activity. Course introduction, meet me, textbooks. All right, now. I have bought and downloaded, and here are the PDFs of the textbooks. Since they're class assignments, I've already bought the books. If you're in the Bulldog Bundle or any of that, get out. You don't need the books. They're right here. If we click on that, you can download them, and you can do your chapters right out of them. That might take a minute because they're both 500 pages long. You can do it. There it comes. Look at that. There they are. Right here are your books. And since I'm having you do class assignments, I went ahead and purchased them and put them in there. Okay, I'll get back to her in a minute. All right, let me get back to where I am here. All right, so now, and here's our schedule. Let me get that out of the way. And remember, attendance is required. So here's what we do. So tonight we're doing, but I've got everything that we're going to cover all semester long is right here already. I've paced your evidence. Employee development plan right here. So it's right there. Right here is the evidence, the employee development plan, the materials for them. And then the last Sunday, you will present your actual plan. Now, along the way, I have other assignments for you on Saturdays. Now, your weekly assignments. So Glickman and Bowman and Deal is right here. All you got to do is open that up. And what that's going to tell you is this. So whether you're a Wayne student, my other class section for tomorrow night or tonight, that there are your chapter assignments. Now, I used very high level reasoning to develop this schedule in that I went alphabetical. If you want to trade with somebody else on the list, if you know you got something going on in your life, don't involve me in that, but that's fine with me. As long as next week somebody's presenting chapters 1 through 3 of Glickman, I'm good. And then somebody needs to do chapters 4 and 5, and then somebody, 6 and 9. You can see how it works. So next week, we're going to cover chapters 1, 3, 4, 5, 6 through 9. And then the following week, and you can see how that works until we cover that whole book. And then we'll move to the next book, the Bowman and Deal book. And you see how that goes again. But again, I have done this alphabetically. If y'all want to trade, that's fine with me. But now don't involve me in that negotiation. But that's what we will do. Our weekly sessions, every week, you will present your chapters. Now, I don't expect, right, here's the assignment drop box that goes with it. You just put them right here. Upload your presentation. It can be a Word document or a PowerPoint. I don't expect a PowerPoint every week. If you just want to do a document, an outline, a graphic organizer, don't spend a lot of time on the actual, because I want you to learn to speak extemporaneously. Speak from notes. The worst problem that I have is people go through this program, they get to their proposal defense or their final defense, and they want to come in and read it to us, and they want to have 1,000 words on a PowerPoint. Let me show you the most involved PowerPoint that I've ever made. I'll just tell on myself right now. Let me find it. Let me see. I'll probably have to switch here. I'll just switch. This is for my doc class, one of the others. As you can see, this thing is fighting me tonight. I'll get out of that one. I'll get in this one. I'll make it easier on myself. Aha. When I do PowerPoints, this is what it looks like. That's it. It's 10 slides long. Because what am I going to do when I present this? I'm going to speak extemporaneously about each of these things. Now, I'm going to say something ugly. Won't be the first time. This is not CNI. This is not EDCI. This is EDLS. We don't have meetings to do the work of the organization. We have meetings to plan and then go do the work of the organization. LS people, the meeting is not the work. Now, you said, Dale, them EDCI people are the bane of your existence. Well, yeah. But here's the irony of my life. I've been married to one of them for 40 years. I've been married to an EDCI lady for 40 years. I love them. I love her better than my next breath. But they're different than us. This is not curriculum instruction. I don't want to see PowerPoints with 1,000 words per slide, and then you sit and read them. I want to see big ideas on slides. You're going to be working with adults. You're a school administrator. You must be able to speak extemporaneously without reading notes. If you need to read notes, this is not the career for you. This is not the career for you if you have to sit and read notes. If you have to entertain us with graphics and Canva and all that other stuff and Prezi and have all that stuff, that means you don't know anything. And people will know that quickly that you're trying to leave. They'll know it quickly. So I prefer outlines. I prefer graphic organizers. I prefer very simple PowerPoints, no color. Again, don't discriminate against me. I'm over 65. I'm colorblind now. It's age related. I don't want to see watermarks and background pictures and all that stuff. I can't read it. I want big print. But I want to know what you know. I want you to be able to speak from your heart and extemporaneously. I want you to be able to lead people. You can't lead people reading a PowerPoint. It will not happen. It will not work. Again, we don't have meetings to do the work in LS. We have meetings to organize and then go do work. I'm asked all the time, explain the difference between LS and EDCI. Very simple. If Daryl came over to me and said, I need to get up on the roof, I'd say one of two things to Daryl. Either I'll get my ladder, or I know a man with a ladder. I would not ask Daryl why we needed to get up on the roof. I've already assumed the problem with him. We need to get up on the roof now. You see, I've already, that's leadership. I've already assumed that problem. You know, now it's our problem. We have a shared problem. I don't care why he needs to get up on the roof. I know Daryl, he's a good man. He wouldn't have us going on a wild goose chase. We're not getting up there just to get the kids' frisbee down. We need to get up on the roof. He doesn't need to have to explain all that to me or indemnify himself, you know, blame somebody else or come up with some reason or rationale why. Now, curriculum people would say, Daryl, why don't you get up on the roof? And they need to have a meeting. Maybe put together a PLC and study it. And about 6 months from now, we might decide whether we're going to get up on the roof. And by that time, the roof done fell in because it was leaking. That's not who we are. That's not what we do. I had a group the other day that I worked with in Goldsboro this summer. And I said, I don't understand y'all. Y'all complain like curriculum people. We don't complain. LS people do not complain. We find solutions to problems. Anybody can stand around and point problems out. Your job as a leader is to find solutions to problems. We don't sit and complain. They're not problems. They're just opportunities for us to exercise our leadership, to get stuff done. I expect that to be reflected in the work that you do. You say, boy, I got all these chapters to do. Don't wear yourself out making PowerPoints. Take some notes and talk to me about what you read. That would make me happy. That would make me happy every week. All right. Let me get back over here. Okay. All right. Now, so here are the textbooks where you get your chapters. I've got your attendance, getting started in your course, your clinical log. You know, you got to do 30 hours. You're on your own honor to do that. Introduce yourself. Here's your task stream evidence, the employee development plan. Here's the rubric step for success. I've got it all laid out for you here. Right here's the rubric. Here's the directions right here, part A, part B, part C, part D. And then it tells you all about it. I've also done you another little paper here, Steps for Success, what we used to call templates in the MSA program. The artifacts that must be present, that means things. Artifacts are things. Right here they are. I've got them laid out for you. You're welcome. All right. So that's your evidence. You can read it. You can see. I've told you, right, here's my notes. Again, do you see that it didn't take 20 pages either, did it? Pretty simple stuff. Simple, to the point. Right, here's the rubric. There it is. That's your evidence this semester. You'll present it on the last Sunday. Got to put it obviously and turn it in. You know that. Here's your presentation directions and schedules right here. Here's the Dropbox for whatever. If all you write down is, Dale, I read it, and this is what I learned. I don't care if it's two sentences long. Here's the Dropbox. I want to know what you can tell me. So here's your Dropboxes. Here's the directions and schedule. I've already shown you that. Right there it is. That's the directions. That's the schedule. Graphic organizer, very simple, very direct, hard to mistake. Zoom class 2, which is next week. I expect to see these 3 presentations right here, and then on so forth and so on. Easy peasy, not hard. Here's some school district. This is the kinds of things we'll talk about when I'm with you on Saturday. Here's, again, dissertation materials. I'll cover these on Saturdays. Zoom class 1, right here's what it says we're doing tonight. Look at that. Zoom class 2, chapter presentations. First Saturday, adult learning theory. What is andragogy? Pillars of adult learning theory, why teachers stay or leave, county partnership, teacher. This is about personnel. Why they come and why they go, how to get them, why they stay. But remember, this is a personnel class. That's what 734 is. So that's we got to know about staying and going. There's Hertzberg right there. Seminal work on why they stay or go. Adults. We got to figure out how adults learn, and if we can't figure that part out, we can't keep them, or we can't recruit them, or we don't know what we're looking for. So we're going to do adult learning theory and retention the first Saturday, plus some of those other things. Study student presentations are right here. You've got 3 activities that you need to do between now and then. Let me see. What 4 qualities you look for when hiring a teacher assistant? Be specific and explain yourself. I don't care if it's not, but one. What are you looking for? That's one of your activities. One of your other activities that first Saturday, read the linked article and get me a 1-page response at max on how your district mentors new staff. That's very important in personnel, that induction phase. And then what is your district doing to recruit? 1 page again. When I say 1 page, I mean 1 page. That means the maximum. I'm a friend of the environment. Don't use up any more trees than you have to on paper. All right. So those are the first 3 activities that you have on that are due on that Saturday. All right, so that's, and then Zoom class 3 again, back to student presentations 4. Weekend 2, Saturday, I will do HR. Probably do some, you know, we'll follow up on human resources and continue with that micro-credentialing, department challenges, pathways, you know, residency teacher, we'll go through all that kind of stuff. Probably may even do a little Qualtrics that afternoon on how to do surveys. Because that's one of the things, not just for dissertation. If we're looking at employee satisfaction, what should we be doing? We should be asking them. If you know how to use Qualtrics, we can put that together. Not, it's just kind of a 2 birds with 1 stone kind of thing. You know, if you want to know, you ask. If you want to know why people are staying or going, or what we could do to help, or those kinds of things. In terms of the challenges of why people staying or why they're going, you know, if we could use a survey, we could ask people. Same survey that we use, and we can do analysis for your dissertation, but there's other uses for it as well, practical applications. Zoom class 5, Zoom class 6, and then our last weekend, again, I'm going to cover more things on human resources. I'm going to do management at the school level. We're going to focus on human resources at the school level. And then on Sunday, you'll do your employee development plan presentations. Did I get the weekend Sunday present? No, I missed that one, I think. All right. So the middle weekend human resources plan template, you got to do an HR director interview and an HR plan for the middle weekend. They're right here. Let's look at that one right quick. It'll open. You can do it. Right here's the template. It's right there. Download it. This is middle weekend Sunday. This is one of your activities. Let me get this one right here. Right there it is. Six slides long. Guess who made that? Who's that look like? That's what I'm talking about. That's the kind of stuff I like right there. Because you can speak to it extemporaneously. And you're not standing and reading it. It insults adults to sit and read PowerPoints, or it does me. And then the other one is your HR director interview. You need to interview them. And right here is here's the questions. Again, eight of them. Pretty simple. Got them written out for you and got a document. All right. And so that's the middle Sunday. Then the last Sunday you present your evidence for the semester, your employee development plan. And then our last class, I'll probably do something on Zoom. We'll catch up wherever we've missed. If we're good, I may even cancel it, or we might do something in terms of doctoral work. We might do something like that. So that's the semester right there. That's everything that you've got to do. There's nothing hidden. Now, I don't do lates. I don't do late work. You'll get it when you get it. You're grown people. You're adults. I don't have due dates. I don't do late. Just get your work done. Handle your business. Again, we're LS. We are LS. Our job is to get stuff done. We handle our business. We don't see problems. We only see opportunities. That's what we do in LS. I love them curriculum ladies, one of them particularly, but they ain't, that's not us. We don't talk, we do. All right. Questions you have for me. Now, I did you a color code. That's the last thing I want to cover tonight, I promise. I did you a color code. Now, again, I expect attendance at all sessions because that's, you know, all none of these are, this is all synchronous. So I did you a color code. Right here it is. So if you miss tonight, if the people that miss tonight can come tomorrow night. Right here, I color code. Now, if you miss next week, you can come the following week on Thursday, or the following 2 weeks on Thursday, right there, 2 weeks later. See how the color coding works. Now, if you're going to miss this one, you better know beforehand and come the week before. But I've color coded all of these so that you can see that there's an alternative. And the weekends are the same way. If you can't come, just let me know. Now, I can't indemnify you. I can't let you not attend class. But now you don't have to tell everything you know. But there's the schedule. You got to work it out with where you're going to be and what you're going to be doing. Okay. Questions you have for me, anything about the expectations? You have an evidence, you have Sunday activities that where you have to present, and then you have weekly chapters. This is a doing kind of thing. And again, the books are already there. I've already bought them. You don't have to buy them since we're using them for class assignments. Sarah, I know you got a question.
Okay, so I just want to clarify that the Sunday stuff we need to have done before the weekend. We're not working on it during the weekend.
No, you're presenting on Sunday, unless you want to stay all day.
Okay.
My plan is, if you have your stuff already done and we don't have to take the morning for you to work on it, we get out by lunchtime on Sunday. But I can stay as long. I'm old. I can still drive at night, so I can stay all day.
Okay.
So if you want to get out at lunchtime on Sunday, have your stuff ready to present when you get there. Now, if y'all prefer to work on it that morning and stay till 4 o'clock, I'll stay with you. That's your incentive to have it done when we get there on Sunday morning. I mean, as long as we can get out by 12 or 1, we're good. We don't do lunch on Sundays. We just have continental breakfast. I'll bring some stuff and coffee and water and off we go. And then on Saturdays we'll order out, or I'll let you go, one or the other. Sometimes I just get Jason's Deli. I'll send you a Qualtrics survey, what you want from Jason's Deli, and I spring for that. But we have stuff. We figure out what we're going to eat when we meet the first time. But now, Sundays, I like to be out by no later than 1. But that's up to y'all. If y'all want to do your, if you want to come in and work for a couple, 3 hours on the stuff in the morning and then present in the afternoon, that's fine with me too. But, you know, we're in Charlotte, and you know this fall is ball games. You stay till 4 o'clock, and it'll be midnight before you get home because you'll be in the ball game traffic. There's always a ball game on Sunday in Charlotte. Always. Basketball, football, soccer, something on Sunday. And so what we try to do is we try to hit it. You know, the game start at 1 o'clock. We try to end right then because that's when the traffic, everybody's where they're going to be at 1 o'clock, the bars or the stadium for the ball game. And that gives us a path to get home. But if we go much past halftime, then it's going to be way on the night before we get home. That's up to you. Again, be redundant. That's up to y'all. I would prefer you have your stuff ready when we roll in on Sunday morning. What's next? Have y'all done a lot of collaborative teamwork so far? That's what I thought. That's what I've been told. You notice we're not doing any this time much. We might do some later. I might have you do some for that middle weekend, but I've been told that y'all done that. We need to kind of start depending on ourselves. I like collaborative teams, but again, this is a leadership training program. You need to learn how to work in a collaborative team, but you also need to learn how to depend on yourself. And so traditionally, this course has not been a collaborative. This has been a one-off where you do the projects yourself. We might can modify that a little bit, but this has always been the course where you do what you do. And the reason why is because the credit hours. You understand that this is a 9-credit-hour course? And so there has to be enough individual work to justify 9 credit hours. On the 6-credit-hour courses, they do a lot of collaborative work because you obviously don't have as much work to do. But this is a 9-hour course. And so if we were to do some of this stuff collaboratively, again, you don't have to tell everything you know. I'm supposed to have enough work for you to do to justify on your own 9 credit hours. So that's why we don't do collaborative work in this one as opposed to the others. They were 6, this one's 9. Next question. Well, look at y'all, got done 15 minutes early tonight. 18 minutes early. All right. There's nothing else for the good of the group. Anybody have any announcements they want to make? All right. Somebody look at the schedule. When's the next time we're together?
Next week.
That is correct. We're together next week. And what are we going to be doing?
Some people are going to be presenting chapters.
That is exactly right. Some people are going to be presenting chapters next week. Now, again, the big thing is again, this is a 9-hour course. You say, Dale, you've given us a lot of work to do. Got all these chapters to read, these assignments, all this stuff to do, all these presentations. Again, it's a 9-hour course. It's 1.5 times what you've done before. And we're prepping you. How many credit hours is one next semester in the spring? 12.
12.
So as one of my wise friends who's Indian, Curry, not bow and arrow, says, relaxly. We've been kind of relaxly so far. That's what Vishy says. We're going to ramp up now. And so we're in that ramping up phase. We're going from 6 to 9, and then next semester you go to 12. And so Yes, there's a lot to do, but no apologies. It's a 9-hour course. So I'm expecting next Tuesday that I'm going to have three presentations of three chapters of the book, and we'll talk about those and argue. And y'all need to talk more next week. All right. Anything else? All right. I appreciate you. Appreciate you choosing the EDLS program, Gardner Webb. I will see y'all all next Tuesday at 7. If you're in touch with any of your classmates, tell them to make sure that they're there with us. I expect to see everybody next Tuesday. All right. Everybody have a good, or next, this is, yeah, next Wednesday. Everybody have a good week. Thank you.
All right. You as well.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.